gentlemen, and welcome to the Polyhedron Collider Cast, episode 4, take 2.
Whoops.
Yeah.
People are going to ask where take 1 is now.
Yeah, well...
No one needs to hear that.
No.
On the cutting room floor.
It's in the bin. It's long gone. Yeah, standing up to our byword of ramshackle, I made a little bit of an error of our microphone settings and recorded the previous podcast, and, well, I sounded great on it. I sounded absolutely brilliant. Yeah, yeah. John sounded like he was in another room, and Andy sounded like he was a robot under a duvet.
So pretty normal then.
Well, yeah.
But even more so. Than
even more so. Speaking of them, I'm joined by my normal two co-hosts.
Andy, Tony Cage.
And John Cage.
Welcome, chaps. Hello.
Hello.
Now, the other thing as well, this one might be a bit more civilised than usual. Yes. I don't know if it's easy to tell, but usually we've had a couple of beers in us, and since we're trying to re-record things, we've all got a nice cup of tea.
We're just lacking crumpets now.
We're also not quite so fired up from a game of nail-biting pandemic as well. Which...
That's true.
Yes.
Wednesday's game was pretty tense, actually.
Yes, that was the most tense so far, actually.
It really was.
So that was Pandemic Legacy, was that...
That was March.
March.
Yeah.
That was it. It was our fourth game because we screwed up February.
We did.
So we're on March. So we're still 2 months behind real life because it's coming up to May.
That's true. We need to catch up.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was like we were one turn away from like success or failure.
It was definitely going to go one of two ways.
Yes.
But there was no, oh, we'll just wing it for a couple of turns. No.
No. It was pretty damn close. I'm quite pleased with what they've done with that so far.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. I think it's probably worth, before we go too far into it, we will probably talk about Legacy games at some point.
Yes. But I will wait until we're a lot further along with Pandemic Legacy, because... as I said, we're still only about a third of the way through that game. Yeah. It could go either way. We could end up hating it by the end. We could end up loving it.
So this time next year when we finished it.
Yes.
You're quite optimistic there.
So last weekend, I went to Salute 2016, which is the miniature war games show in London.
Cool.
Loads of war games companies there, showing off all kinds of things. Lots of war games clubs as well, showing off miniatures.
Nice.
What I did do, or what I did play, which was quite interesting, was the Dark Souls board game.
Ooh.
Now, this was a demo version of the game, and this was 2 days before the Kickstarter happened. Now, at the time of recording, it's about 10 days to the Kickstarter?
Something like that. From the Kickstarter.
No, actually, it's a week. It's a week. So by the time you hear this, it'll be about 10 days since Kickstarter started.
Right.
And they're already on like £1.5 million.
Out of a possible...
Well, it's Kickstarter, so...
No, I realise. What was their target, sorry?
Their target was something ridiculous, like 200,000.
Well, that's a marginal success.
Yeah.
So they've done okay.
They've done okay, yeah. And they're still going. So I don't think either of you two have played the Dark Souls video games or Bloodborne or Demon Souls.
No.
Right. So, let's start from the beginning.
I'm not aware of them. I've heard of them, but I've not played them.
Well, they're quite a cult game, really. Started off with Demon's Souls on the PlayStation. Dark Souls was one that came out on every single platform. And then there's three of them. And Bloodborne, which takes a lot of what the other games did and mixed it up a bit. But they're basically third-person action RPG video games, is the way I describe them.
Right, okay.
Dark Souls, it's kind of it's a medieval fantasy world, so you've got your knight, and he's got his sword and his shield, and you've got dragons, and you've got undead. But it's almost like post-apocalyptic.
A bit of a mash of genres, then.
Well, it's almost like as if what would happen if a fantasy world died of a zombie apocalypse.
Okay.
So the entire world is dying around you, and most of the enemies you meet are undead in some kind of way. Castles are crumbling into ruins, and things are overgrowing, and things like that.
So it's like Friday Night in Worcester, then.
Worcester's not that bad.
I don't know,
I've had a Friday night in Wrexham.
Oh god, wow, yeah, okay, that one wins.
That one is full of undead trolls.
God, yes.
So it's a game that's quite famous for being difficult. And it's difficult because it doesn't tell you anything.
Okay.
It kind of just throws you in and goes, off you go.
Right, is this Demon's Souls, the first one? The only reason I asked this question is because Yahtzee made a massive point of this being like grammatically awkward. run his review of Demon's Souls. Yes, I think it is
Demon's Souls, so and Dark Souls.
The Souls of Many Demons.
Yes.
Right.
I think that's what happens. You fight many demons and you get the souls.
I didn't know. I didn't actually realise that Bloodborne and T'other One were sequels. I didn't know.
Right, so Dark Souls has had three direct games. It's Dark Souls 1, 2 and 3.
Right.
Bloodborne is the same software team and there's a hell of a lot of similarities.
Okay.
It's, I'm trying to give a good example. It's like going to a curry house and the difference between a chicken tikka rogan josh and a chicken balti.
It's, well, all right.
It's still curry.
It's still a curry. They're still very similar in flavour, but there's subtle differences between
them. It's like Baldur's Gate, Dragon Age and Mass Effect. Is basically what he's.
I would even go so far as like Baldur's Gate and Icewind Dale.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it's they're the same, but with subtle differences.
Same game engine, same system, but.
Yeah, there's some changes. I see. Sure. So the whole game has got this whole thing of not telling you what's going on, kind of just throwing you in. I mean, quite literally says, here's how to use a shield, here's how to use a sword.
Good luck.
Good luck. Off you go.
Oh, right, okay.
And then when you actually fight, it's like I said, third person action, so it's third person fighting, and you're swinging the sword and all that. You've got to have pretty precise timing to dodge out of the way and block.
Hmm.
So that's quite difficult to try and make into a board game, but I thought what they did was really good.
So, how does it compare? How does the mechanics and things work in the game, the board game versus the computer game?
Well, what they did was you had a card with your health on. So this very war game style thing where you'd have a card in a sleeve and things were marked off with a dry erase marker.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's quite common in war games. War Machine has it. That's quite common. And what you had was stamina and health all on the same bar. So as you
harsh.
Yeah, well, this game is harsh.
Mm.
The whole idea was every time you took an action, you knocked off a stamina. And you could take as many actions as you wanted. So if you moved the space, it was one, cross off a stamina. If you made an attack, cross off a stamina.
Bloody hell. And does it ever come back again?
Well, that's it. You could rest, which was pass your action, and clear any used stamina. Or you could take your Estus Potion, which people who played Dark Souls will know what that is, which clears all your health. And the Estus Potion's got like 5 uses.
Okay.
So what it meant was you knew you could take more actions, but you also knew that the more actions you took, the more chance you had a hit from the boss killing you.
Right.
Okay, I see. That's
and
quite,
then every so often you have to take a tactical decision to maybe spend a couple of stamina to move out of the way and then rest and clear all your actions.
So running, poke him in the ribs and then run away again.
Yeah, which if anyone's playing in the Dark Souls games, that's basically how you play. You run in, wait until you think you've got an opening, run in, swing, hit. Oh crap, I've done him a sliver of damage and I need to run out of the way. And it was really quite clever with that. And the way they did the boss as well, they said, we only did a boss fight. So we didn't play the actual game. The full game will have you raising at the bonfire, which is what happens in the video game, making your way through a small dungeon where you'll fight some minor monsters, and then you'll make your way to the boss. And we just did this boss fight. And the way it was done was these programmed cards. So there were so many cards which represented the different actions the boss would make.
Right.
And they would flip over and go, right, okay, he turns to face whoever had the aggro. It'll then do this sequence of attacks, like charge forward, swing, turn to the right again. And that would also show you which corner of the boss, because the boss was split into like a quadrant, was open. And if you could attack that section before he moved again, you'd get an extra dice of damage.
Nice. Yeah. So it sounds almost similar to Robo Rally, in the sense that these are his actions.
Yeah.
So they're almost predetermined. Obviously, in Robo Rally, you don't get that, but you've got to determine them yourself.
Imagine if you're playing Robo Rally against someone else, but you can move your robot when you want, and somebody else is programming the actions.
Right.
That's kind of what it felt like.
Mm, okay.
So, yeah, the boss had these predetermined. I mean, shuffled, you didn't know the order they were in, but you knew that these attacks were coming. And when you got to the end of the deck, you just put them back again, so you knew the attacks
in
the
same order.
Didn't reshuffle them.
Oh, that's a bit weird.
Well, that was a clever thing, because what you could try and do then was if you could remember which attack came next. All right, okay, he's just done the big attack with a sweeping sword.
So you can take advantage of it.
Oh, hang on, which attack came next? Did he do the one where he just ran away and healed, or did he do the one where he just charged forward and battered through you? And if you could try and remember which one it was, then you could try and get yourself out of his attack area and then in his weak area ready to hit him.
So you've sort of got... you don't have your own DM or anything. You're playing cooperatively, but the cards determine what the baddie's going to do rather than a person.
So it's a fully cooperative.
It almost sounds like something like Super Mario. You just watch what Bowser's going to do and then follow him round. You have to hit him three times and you win.
It's not far off that, because that's what that video game thing is. It's a very Japanese video game as well. It's, you know, almost esoteric in its menu system and trying to work out what you can do. And that boss thing kind of comes from that.
Kind of area. Interesting.
It has got a bit of a weird feedback though, because I said the Kickstarter has been going for about a week now, and a lot of people have taken in. I've almost been insulted by the fact there's a dice in it, because the argument is also always that Dark Souls, though it's tough, is not mean. Whereas dice represent random amounts of damage, and they say if you know how to play Dark Souls and you can get in, swing the hit, you do the same amount of damage every time.
Right.
Now I think, having played it, I think that's a little bit of the board game side sneaking in. You need a little bit of randomness.
We like randomness. Yeah. Well, I like randomness.
I also don't think that a board game can mimic that like precise timing you need in a video game.
Yeah.
I mean, I've played it. I've run up to a boss and swung the sword, and I've missed him by like 2 millimeters and scratched his ankle rather than hitting him hard with the sword, which is something you can't mimic in a board game.
Mm.
And I also think anyone who doesn't think Dark Souls is mean should go back and fight that fucking Capra demon, because he's a bastard.
I get the impression there may have been a few hours lost there.
Was a controller launched towards the television, Steve?
I got to the Capra demon and stopped playing the game for about 3 months.
That's a major rage quit.
Because I refused to go back.
Wow.
And finally went back and kind of went, right, I'm not going to go straight to the Capra demon. I'm going to go level up somewhere else. You know, I'm going to kill some low-level minions and get a better weapon, that kind of thing. But still a pain in the ass. Basically, it puts you in this little tiny room and then attacks two dogs on you. You basically walk in the room, the dogs attack you, so you get staggered, you can't do anything, and then he hits you with a massive axe.
I say that's hardly sporting.
It doesn't sound like the most fun.
No, it's not.
That sounds like most RPGs. I'll try this a couple of times. Okay, that's not worked. I'll buff a couple of times, see if that makes a difference. That's not worked. Bollocks to it, I'm coming back when I'm higher level.
Yeah.
There must be another way.
Yes.
I was quite pleased with Dark Souls. I thought it really got the feel of the video game. Mm-hmm. Okay, I had to change some way and mechanics to get it to work, but it felt like I was fighting the boss character in Dark Souls, which I think was really quite impressive.
The images you've shown on the website definitely look impressive. The boss, it looks enormous.
Oh yeah,
are we talking sort of greater demon from Warhammer type sort of size?
That kind of scale, yeah. Right. So about 10 centimeters tall.
That's pretty big.
Was the boss, and then they've released a picture of the gaping dragon.
We were.
Well, you wouldn't say you were if you'd seen it. And they reckon that model's like about the size of a dinner plate.
Bloody hell! Grief. That's part of the game.
That's one of the add-ons.
Right.
So you can, I think it's like 28 quid you can do to get that. Oh. And they've done 4 dragons, and that's the one they've released.
Okay. Do we have a feel of how much the base game would cost once it gets released?
Right. The Kickstarter price is about 80 quid.
Right.
But that's going to include all the add-ons. And the add-on dragons at the moment are about 28 quid. So I think they haven't said, but I would have thought 80 to 100 quid when it comes out.
Right. Okay. That's
the going price at the moment for a board game with lots of miniatures.
Yeah.
If you consider things like the Cool Mini or Not games, like Blood Rage and Arcadia Quest, if you look at what Fantasy Flight Games are doing, the Star Wars Rebellion, which I've just bought and still haven't played, which is making my teeth itch.
I've got a big table, Steve.
You have as well. It would go and fit so nicely on that table. Go. I mean, that's 80 quid.
Yeah.
The Games Workshop ones at the moment, they're doing, because Games Workshop are doing a lot of board games with a lot of miniatures, they're about 100 quid.
Mm. How much was Horus Heresy? It's about 80 quid.
That's about 80 quid, yeah. So I mean, I'm expecting it to be in that kind of ballpark.
Mm. That's not unreasonable. Mm-hmm. And it's Fantasy Flight, so it's obviously going to have a premium of £10.
Well, yeah, but this is by this game is by Steamforge, and the only game they've done before was Guild Ball, which is a miniatures game.
Right.
A miniatures football game.
Ah, so is it a little bit like Blood Bowl then?
Well, when I say football, I mean like proper football.
Soccer?
Yeah.
Yes.
Soccer.
Soccer.
For you Americans out there.
So it's
football.
And it's based on the kind of old-fashioned medieval football.
Oh, brilliant.
As in,
so a funny shaped pig's bladder.
Yeah, get a pig's bladder and kick it from one end of the village to the other.
Fantastic.
It looks pretty cool, actually.
I have to give that a go. We can get our hands on it.
Yeah. Well, keep me in to have a go at it, but I saw Dark Souls and thought I'm going to play that instead.
So it's presumably then Dark Souls is pretty much like an advanced beta at the moment.
Yeah, this was just a demo copy.
Right.
They're not. I don't think the game's actually going to release for another year or so. It's just the Kickstarter's on at the moment.
So. Sure. So they're tweaking the mechanics and building the miniatures and all that sort of jazz. Mm. Okay.
Yeah. Nice. So speaking of expensive games, you splashed out a bit of cash lately, haven't
you? Yeah.
Has your disorder been flaring up again?
A little bit, yeah. Yeah. Well, I say bit, quite a lot. I had a moment of weakness. I'll say a moment, it was more like about half an hour, of weakness in one of our local game shops in Worcester. I just happened to be wandering around town, went into Minor League, and Empire's Age of Discovery was sat on the shelf. And I'd not even heard of it before. I thought, ooh, that's a big shiny box, what's in there? So I pulled it off the shelf and nearly gave myself a hernia. It's enormous, and it weighs a ton. So I thought, ooh, that's even more attractive. It's passed the weight test, tell me more, Mr. Shopkeeper. So I sort of ran away and then came back again later on going, yeah, all right, I'll have it. So I paid...
How long did you spend away thinking...
About half an hour.
Did you actually make it as far as the door of the shop?
I did. I got out of the shop and went into Toys and Games across the road.
To see if they had it for cheaper.
Yes. Oh, and then came back again.
Just to tell you, the listeners, we're quite blessed in Worcester because there's four shops, not including Games Workshop, that sell games.
Mm. Yeah.
And two of them are more or less across the road from each other.
Yeah, it's
so
very dangerous.
You can check whether the prices match up between the two really easily.
I think between the two of them, they really have a fantastic selection. They really do. Mm. I think Manor League's probably slightly, quote, geekier in a way.
Yes.
A little bit more specialised, but it's a board game.
Specialised, that's one way of describing it. As in, what he means is it smells a bit in there.
Yes, there's a few more beards.
There's a few more neck beards going on.
You can hear the gentle rustling as they move around the shop.
The occasional tweeting of a sparrow that happens to have got lodged in there. And then Toys and Games is like a sort of, it's a Toy Master or a Hobby Master, something like that. And
yeah, well, one of their big stars is Lego. They're a big Lego shop.
Oh, huge, yeah. But they've got tons of Star Wars in there.
Yeah.
Thankfully, I have managed to resist their call. But anyway, what I bought, I ended up buying Age of Discovery. And it's based on Age of Empires 3, for anyone who's partaken in any of the Age of Empire computer games.
Another video game link.
Yes. Yeah, we're doing well.
Anyone would think we're geeks or something.
I don't understand how they get that impression. It turns out it's actually, you know, having done the research after I bought the game, you know. it turns out it's actually a remake of Age of Empires 3 based on tons of feedback from the collective. Because Age of Empires 3 was apparently plagued by various play issues, and there was an expansion from Age of Empires 3 that apparently fixed some of these things and so on and so forth. So was it a Kickstarter, I think, at some point?
Yeah, it was, yeah. Eagle and Griffin Games, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. And it comes with something like 430 miniatures. Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's a lot. You get, basically, this. It's for a game for up to 6 players. And oddly, and I really wasn't expecting this when I opened this, so I've opened the box and it looks amazing inside. It's so well made. It's really high quality. It's really thick cardboard. It is a limited edition, so it's obviously a former Kickstarter. They only do this version of it, and it includes an expansion, which is the Builder's expansion, I think it is. I'm sure a set of little miniatures as well that you get. So they add a few mechanics to the game. I haven't actually played it with the expansion yet. But
is that 430 plus the expansion?
No, it's all in.
Right.
So the expansion's in the game as well, so there's all of these mechanics and miniatures are all in there.
Still a hell of a lot, isn't it?
It is, yeah. So there's 6, or 7, I suppose, sets of miniatures. Mm-hmm. They all look, do you remember Toy Soldiers when you were younger? All the little sort of riflemen and the armies? They look a little bit like that. And so they're all little stands. They're not like Bloodborne or that sort of, or Dark Souls miniatures or anything like that. They are just little sort of tiny, almost like Toy Soldiers.
Yeah.
That sort of style. There's 10... galleon type miniatures or ships, but about the same sort of size, about sort of 2 inches by 2 inches, give or take. Mm-hmm. And then there's 100 doubloons, so 50 silver and 50 gold plastic coins. And they're imprinted like they were in the day. It's all funny shapes.
So,
and it looks really quite good. And as I said, the board's pretty hefty. It's large, really thick cardboard. It's fantastically well made. It's really high quality. So you can, I mean, for the £75 I paid, and having looked around, that's actually quite cheap.
Because
it should be about £85-90 from where I can find it from most places.
Cracky. So you do pay for those miniatures.
You do, but you are getting a lot for your money. It's, I think it's worth it in terms of what you actually get.
Is it worth it in terms of game?
Well, this is an interesting point of discussion, actually, because the game itself, much to my surprise, I wasn't expecting this. I was expecting something more along the lines of the computer game Colonization, if anyone remembers that.
Vaguely.
Which is kind of like a twist on Civilization, which was based on discovering the New World.
Yeah, and I think everyone's played Civ. Everyone, right?
Absolutely, everyone, surely. If you haven't played Civ, you need to go home and seriously think about what you've done.
Or not, as the case.
Or you haven't done, yes.
Go home, buy Civilization and play it. I'll wait.
Okay, good.
And this is essentially Colonization. But the thing I wasn't expecting about the game is actually worker placement, which I really wasn't expecting. I was expecting some kind of, I don't know, maybe a hex placement or an exploration game. And it's, well, it is an exploration game, but not in that sense. There's no unknowns in it. You get a map of the New World, or one side of it, and a bunch of action boxes that you put your miniatures in to determine, you know, like a standard worker placement game. So there's various things you can do, like you can run an expedition to discover a colony, to discover an area of the New World, like Indiana or the Caribbean or Peru or whatever. And you can only send miniatures there once you've discovered it. Or rather, once it's been discovered, because if somebody else discovers it, you can still send people there.
Okay. So then
you can send people over there and set up colonies, and if you've got enough people there, the first person to set up the biggest colony will get like the natural resources there. And then as part of the, there's a mechanic that allows you to take trade goods, and once you've got sets of trade goods, you get money, and with money you can buy upgrades and all this sort of stuff. So
yeah.
As a set of mechanics, the game works really, really well.
So what's the winning condition?
It's a victory points game. So it's ultimately to get as many VPs as you can.
And those come from these resources that you get?
Partially. It's some of the upgrades can influence what VPs you get at the end of the game. Because there's three scoring periods. So the game's set in three ages, which are basically the scoring periods. It's eight turns in total. The end of the third turn, sixth turn, and then obviously the end of the eighth turn, you get scores. And it's basically based on the colonies and the areas that you control at the time of the scoring. So not only do you have to get some colonies, you have to maintain them and keep them.
Okay, because so you're a little bit capture the flag.
Kind of, yes. Yeah, right. That's a really good way of putting it, actually, yes. Because not only do you have to capture it and develop it and keep it, because you'd be invaded from other people, i.e. your opponents, but you've also got to keep it. If you've got an enemy colony in there as well, they get some VPs for being sort of their second. So you get some for first, some for second, but none for third.
Yeah.
If there's a tie, it basically counts you both second. Anyway, so that all happens. But at the end of the game, during each age, the upgrades you can buy, or the types of upgrades you can buy, changes with each age. So they change in the sense that first age, everyone's sort of bundling towards the New World, so they help you explore and expand and give you that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And then towards the end, the game essentially is geared towards, you need VPs now, motherfuckers. buy these upgrades, and you can choose a route to say, like, if you've got tons of money, it's worth buying an upgrade that will give you VPs for every gold you've got on them, or if you've got tons of colonies, it'll give you VPs for that sort of thing. So that's how that works.
So it's worth sort of specialising in one?
Yes, but it does depend on which upgrades come out.
Right.
Because they are random. They're slightly random, yeah. There aren't many, because you get big piles of these things, but then you shuffle them to start with, then you can pull them out. So the thing is, the more that are bought, the more that will come out.
Okay.
So it is random, but it's limited random.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. And some of them are weird as well, because they act instantaneously or over a period of time, or, you know, indefinitely. And one of them, you pay something like, you know, X gold for this, and it says instantaneous, you know, you get essentially half of what you paid, and once, and you're like, why would you ever do that? Like, you pay 15 and you get 8 or something like that. You're like, but I can only do that once. Why would anyone bother buying that? It doesn't make any sense. I was like, nah, that's silly. But anyway.
I thought you were going to say there was then subsequently an upgrade which made it worth it or something.
No, not at all. It's just pointless. It's really stupid.
Is it just a case of trying to burn through that deck? You're researching something just to get to...
Potentially, but everyone has access to them. They're free. They're open to anybody. So it's first come, first served in terms of buying, because it's worker placement. There's a certain number, there's a limited number of slots in each action type.
Yeah.
So it's all done on turn order, and you can buy turn order and with a worker and all sorts of stuff. But you can buy further workers as well, and specialised workers as you go along, like captains who are good at exploration, soldiers obviously good at conquest and also help towards exploration. So the mechanics of the game work really, really well. It's very smooth, very tight, quite intuitive once you get your head round it. However,
knew there was going to be a but.
There is, and it comes back to the I suppose the price, but more actually what you get in the box. I think it's unnecessarily flash.
Sorry, did you just say that?
I know, because I am, quite,
the king of bling.
Yeah.
I'm introducing you as that in the next episode.
The king of bling. Oh, I have to change my Twitter profile now. But it is, because for actually, what I mean, it all works well and it all looks really good. I mean, for anyone who's got access to see my Twitter account, there are a few pictures on there, I think, of this game. And it all looks fantastic and it works really well, but I just think it's a bit OTT.
In what sense?
It's, for what you're actually doing, I don't think you're really gaining anything for having, say, the miniatures. You could have just used standees or tokens or something like that.
Tokens,
exactly.
Yeah. Or even meeples,
yeah, exactly.
Like wooden pieces or something like that.
Oh
yeah.
God, the number of meeples you'd get would be ridiculous. That would outdo five tribes, for God's sake.
Five tribes, the game looks like someone's vomited meeples on a table.
Insane.
It is true that you don't need that level of... I mean, it's nice to have nice miniatures, but even... I mean, like, the original talisman was just cardboard. And let's face it, we all love that.
That's, what, 25 minutes?
Could last a while.
Yeah, but you were biting your lips. Like, chewing on your hand.
But it does come back to what we were talking about last week about, do the games going in favour of miniatures over gameplay. Now, obviously, you have to take into account that this is a limited edition. So it is, by its nature, a blingy version of the game. But as it's the only version of that game, I don't know, I'm in two minds about whether it's worth it in terms of what you get out of the game.
Yeah,
it is a good game, and it looks amazing. And the gameplay itself is very, very, very good. I mean, I really like it, because I quite like worker placement games anyway.
I'm surprised it's worker placement, because I saw pictures of it. I mean, I hadn't read the rules or anything like that, but I thought it was like a dudes on the map game.
Exactly. Like Risk or something.
Yeah, like move your colonists round and you invade everybody. But to find out it's a worker placement, I'm quite surprised.
That's what took me by surprise. I was reading it was a worker placement game. Really? I'm invading things. What are you talking about? that surprised me as well. So, I don't know. It would certainly work as a cheaper version, if Eagle Griffin wanted to release it as a cheaper version, it would certainly work with, say, standees or counters or smaller miniatures or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
But it does work. Okay. But I think it's blingy, to say the least. And the thing that really puzzled me was on the reverse of the board is a second map. It's like a world map rather than just Americas. And you can use that second map to play the game. The thing is, there's no difference to the mechanic. It's just a different map.
Okay.
But
just to spice it up a bit.
Yeah. To give you a different, feel.
So, I mean, is it different in regards of you can only invade neighbouring regions?
Yes,
like that?
So right, it would probably change some invasion strategies.
Yeah.
But other than that, in fact, no, you can't even do that. No, because once colonists are in a particular area, they can't move. They're just static. Yeah, it's a bit weird.
So it just looks different.
Yeah. And they have different reasons. They have different trade goods. And those trade goods on the other side aren't in the game. You have to buy them as a separate pack, which I think is a bit cheeky considering you've just forked out 80 rips.
Yeah.
For small, tiny cardboard tokens. It's about £20 for this expansion. It's crazy.
It does seem like an odd mix of unnecessarily blingy in places and not enough blingy in others.
Exactly. I don't... To have the second side... I mean, I think we were talking about this last week, I think, when we failed to record everything. and Steve suggested that it might have been part of the Kickstarter, as an add-on, which I suspect you're probably right.
And I think it would be part of the production run. Yeah, it'd be cheaper to make one board with two sides than it would to make
a single board.
Kickstarter version, a standard version.
Yeah, I think you're probably right. So that's probably where that comes from. Mm. So, but given that you're getting no advantage for other than bling, so I'm obviously clearly tempted to buy it, for getting the extra tokens. I don't think there's any advantage for doing it unless you just want a very slightly different game experience. Mm. But it is a good game and I do like it. And it does work really, really well. And it is so different with more players. Because I played it with two and I played it with four.
Mm.
And it is crazy
a lot of those
different.
Sorts of games change dramatically when you go from... Actually, just the jump from two to more.
Yeah.
Yes.
Doesn't matter how many more, but two versus... multiple is very different.
Yeah, Euphoria is the same. Mm. You play with two, it's basically a race. You play with three or four, it does actually get quite competitive empires is very similar. When Alora and I played it with the two of us, we barely encountered each other because there's enough map for both of us, as it were. Whereas with more people, there's the same number of territories. So obviously you're in more competition, so there's a lot more interaction and a little bit more fighty. So it does definitely work with three or four. And that's really, really... And obviously the game is for up to six people, so I can see with six it would be quite chaotic, actually.
At the risk of ringing that bell again, it's like playing Talisman with all the expansions on it. But it is, because you can end up at the other end of the board and you just, you know, you just won't see each other. Like, how is it going up there? Yeah, not bad. Carry on.
Which is why I think Death is one of the nice expansions.
Yeah, for Talisman.
Yeah, because it adds something you can do to try and get someone to the other side of the board that's well away from you.
Yeah, although you're both controlling it and at random, so...
Yeah, it does tend to hop around a little bit.
Sort of drifts around the board.
Yeah.
Whispering, it's you. Yeah, pretty much.
Nice.
As a quick aside, I wanted to mention a game I saw at Salute, because you'll talk about this Age of Empires and its blinginess. It was called Dark Deeds. It was this card game, and it's designed by Andy Chambers and the illustrated by Mark Gibbons, who were like ex-90s Games Workshop
guys, yeah.
Okay.
And it looked this really cool game, and apparently it plays really well. I heard really good things about it. Saw it for sale then, thought, oh, I might pick that up. How much is a copy? That's £45, sir.
Oh, sorry, what?
Crikey.
For how what? Much?
For a few cards.
About 100 cards.
Is that
tokens?
It?
Yeah.
Bloody hell.
About a box about the same size as the Exploding Kittens box, that kind of thing.
For 40 quid.
Yeah.
Bloody hell.
Now, they'd gone over the top with the blink. All the tokens in it were laser-cut wood. So laser-cut wood tokens, right. All engraved. There was like a first player marker, I think it was, and it was a big metal coin.
Right.
The size of a saucer.
It's like Mr. T's amulet.
Yeah. And then instead of having a board or just playing the cards out in a row, there was like a little mouse mat material play mat to play it on.
All right.
I looked at it and just kind of went, I don't care how good it is. At 40 quid.
It's not worth it.
Oh, no, for 20 quid? Yep, I would have had it. Yeah. 40 quid.
Way too much.
Yeah.
Speaking of cheaper games, Cage, you've been playing Forbidden Island.
Yeah, so that's certainly is a lot cheaper. I think it was about 20 quid. And it comes in a nice shiny tin.
See, I like that about Forbidden Island. Yeah. I like the tin. It's a really nice setup.
It's nicely packaged. It looks nice inside as well. So you get a bunch of tiles. Basically, the idea of the game is you're landing on this island that's sinking and you've got to collect a load of treasures. So there's four treasures to collect, and each one has a little miniature that comes with it, which all look quite nice, but not over the top. So you land on this helicopter space, and you have various action points, so you can move from one tile to another. It's about six tiles by six tiles or something like that, in a sort of diamond island kind of shape. And each location's got, they're either just generic locations or they're one of the places where you can potentially acquire one of these relics that you're trying to collect. Mm-hmm. So it's a cooperative game, and you've got to get all four of these relics and then get back to the helicopter landing pad before the island sinks. So, which doesn't sound too bad.
Doddle.
Except each time you take a turn, you have to pick up some of these cards, and they'll tell you which bits of the island are going to sink. They don't just disappear; they sort of submerge to begin with, and then if the card comes up again, they sink completely and they can't be restored. So you do have upgrades and things that help you fly around the island, or there are sandbags that help you shore up locations. So if a location starts to sink, you can shore it back up again, and you can stop it disappearing altogether. And obviously, if there's two locations that allow you to acquire one of these relics, if one of them goes, well, you can kind of live with that. But if the second one goes, then that's it. You lose the game.
Nice.
Oh, dear.
Yeah.
You just lost the game.
Not again.
Sorry, guys. Oh, my God, no. Right, I'm putting my foot down. No more of this the game nonsense.
Yeah, Cage, you've been told now.
It's a great game. Anyway.
It's not. It's rubbish.
Just don't understand.
Just saying, bugger, I've lost the game. Every time someone mentions the game on a gaming podcast, it's going to get old quick.
If anyone playing said game, they're going to hate you.
That's probably true.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But at least there's a half-hour grace period where I can't lose it. So,
good grief,
Cage. I say go to XKCD, where there's that one that says Congratulations, you've won. You're free now.
That's it. You can go on with your lives.
Yeah.
Well done. I have to say, I do like Forbidden Dawn. It's by the same guy who does Pandemic, isn't it?
It's Matt Leacock, yes. It's the same design as Pandemic.
Yeah. It is. And as the game goes on, there is that same sort of rising sense of urgency.
Crap.
When you've lost one location, there's only one left and it's starting to sink and you're not quite sure whether you also need to go and get one from another piece over there, but you need to get something in the middle. You need to keep that bit stable to stop so that you still got access to the other bits of the island. And some of the characters do have upgrades, so they might be able to fly from one area to the next, or they might be able to dive between them. One of them's got a diving ability, something like that. But even so, there's definitely this feeling like we're in trouble now if that happens. And as the game goes on, things accelerate as well. So to begin with, you're just drawing two cards if you're playing on the novice setting. We played it on the easiest possible setting. And the first two cards that we drew, I think it might have been my shuffling, but the first two cards basically accelerated it up to basically playing an elite game. Whoops. Which basically means you draw more cards each turn, so more locations start to sink for every time you go around the board.
So it's like the infection in Pandemic, then.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Same kind of thing as well with it ramping up.
Yeah, absolutely. I've played Forbidden Island. Alora introduced me to it. It's one of the things, actually, one of the first sort of modern board games I actually played over recent times. And I really enjoyed it. I think it's a really good mechanic. And as you say, it's kind of Pandemic light, isn't it, really?
Yeah, which after playing several months of Pandemic Legacy felt like a refreshing change.
There was a little coffee break.
Yeah, it's slightly stressful, but nowhere near as bad as Legacy.
Your arse doesn't end up going like a rabbit's nose at the end of it.
And unlike Pandemic Legacy or any of the Pandemic games, you could probably play Forbidden Island with pretty much any age of kids, I reckon.
Yes.
It's not too complicated.
It's much simpler, yeah.
Isn't it a lot quicker as well?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah, but Pandemic's quite a quick game.
It's true.
Standard Pandemic, you can do it in about 3/4 hour.
Yeah, okay.
It took about 30 minutes, so it's not a
It just feels like a lot longer.
Yes. Your heart is pumping.
The one thing that entertains me about the premise of Forbidden Island, actually, because obviously the mechanics all work really, really well, is the notion that these people have gone to this island and they're looking for all these relics, which is great, but then one of the actions, as you mentioned, John, is to shore up. How much earth-moving equipment did they bring with them? Four guys and a fleet of JCBs.
And the image just shows some sandbags, so God knows how that helps things float.
Well, what they haven't told you is that the timeline of this game is over like several years. Mm. It's not like several hours, like we let him leave.
Where is that?
Oh, goodness. You'll have to try, actually, is its sort of pseudo-sequel, Forbidden Desert. I won't tell you much about it, other than it's obviously very similar. Same guy, same sort of style of presentation, but instead of being an island, it's a sort of city in the desert.
So it's sinking in the sand?
Yes. I'll let you play it before we talk about it, because it's slightly different in its mechanic. Mm. There's a bit more to it. So it's kind of... It's almost like he's upgraded Forbidden Island.
Yeah.
And added a few bits and bobs to it. So there's a bit more...
We'll play that one and come back to it.
Yes. Mm. It's good. It's worth playing.
One thing I would like to play again, actually, with Forbidden Island is the fact that we only played two of us.
Mm.
And I think, just what we were saying earlier about, you know, we say more players on certain games works. I'd be interested to know what that game plays with like 3 or 4.
Yeah. So would I, because I've only played it with 2 so far.
Yeah.
Because you think it would accelerate the island sinking?
Accelerate the island sinking. You've got more to consider. So by the time it comes right round to you, lots have happened. And then you've also got the Muppet factor.
You speak for yourself, Tudor.
Well, I can guarantee if you play any cooperative game with 4 people, there'll be one person who won't do what everyone else wants them to do.
Leroy Jenkins!
Every single time there'll be one person like, right, our optimum move is to do this, is to go to this area, cure that disease, eradicate that disease and move there. And he goes, I don't want to do that. I'm going to fly over to the other side of the map.
And have a Chinese. Yom,
yom, yom. And swap these and two cards with him.
I might have my fried chicken.
Yeah.
but you're in danger there, Steve, of becoming that guy in the cooperative game.
The guy who plays
it for everyone else.
I try not to be. I can see myself doing it sometimes.
So I'm going to go here and I'm going to do that. What did I do, Steve? What did I do wrong?
Oh, no, that's not too bad. The sucking of teeth and frowning is not the worst one.
Really?
The worst kind of the one is the one that says to you, now you want to do this. You need to fly to Atlanta, swap cards with him, and then cure the disease. I don't want to do that. No, that's your best move. No, save your time. I'll do it for you. Cut the pieces off the table and start moving around.
Mm. To your credit, you have not done that yet in our pandemic games.
Yet.
No, we are.
We lose some fingers.
Yeah. We have an open discourse at the moment.
I've seen it happen in one game of Pandemic where somebody did that, and I'm not kidding, if looks could kill, that one would have blown up the building.
Oh, good lord. You never touch another man's meeple.
No.
Beg your pardon.
But it's a good game. No, I think you can definitely tell it's a LECOG game because it's basically the same. Which is interesting because, I mean, obviously we're playing Pandemic Legacy now with three players, and it is. Because I've played Pandemic with two players, and it's definitely more tense. You can get more done in a turn, obviously, because there's more people. So in a round, I should say, rather than a turn. Because there are more players.
Yeah.
So you get more actions to do things. But obviously, there are more things to do.
Yeah.
So I can imagine Forbidden Island.
What's Forbidden Island go up to, is it?
Four. I think it's four.
I thought it was four.
Two to four, yes. It's in the box, yeah.
Because...
Yeah.
Pandemic and non-legacy, I think you can take it up to six.
It is six, I believe, yes.
At that point, yeah.
That's insane.
It is. It gets really difficult then. Yeah. Ooh. The first time I played with six people, I also meant to play an easy game and accidentally shuffled in all the Epidemic cards.
Nice.
So not only were six people playing, but we had six Epidemic
played
cards.
Played it on Legendary.
Yeah.
Oh, good lord. Is it Legendary or is it just hard?
That's just hard because the
you get Legendary
in the expansions.
Yeah.
Thankfully, I didn't have the expansion at that point in time.
I just looked because I've got all of the expansions for Pandemic. Well, I've got On the Brink and In the Lab.
Right, yeah, same two I've got, I think. Yeah.
Have you got In the Lab? Fantastic.
Yeah, I've got them both. I've never played either of them. Because it's one of those games that every time I decide to get the Pandemic out, I end up playing it with someone new and don't want to subject them to any expansions. I mean, I got the same problem with Arkham Horror.
Yeah,
I own all but two expansions of Arkham Horror, and you need to have someone who knows the game inside out before you introduce like a whole rule book full of extra mechanics for this extra board you're going to play on.
So, otherwise you just lose the people.
I have the same problem with Eclipse, actually. Because... On the Brink introduces additional types of basically modes of play.
Mm.
And you can actually have one person as a bioterrorist who's basically actively trying to stop everybody else winning the game. So just by setting off little sort of virus bombs everywhere. And you've got to try and catch him. So it's almost like the game Scotland Yard, which I've mentioned before. So you're trying to catch this dude running around the world and obviously stopping all of the viruses as well.
Mm.
But it also introduces Legendary difficulty, which you get something like eight Epidemic cards. It's
like one every other draw.
It's just insane.
It sounds pretty harsh.
Yeah, I was reading it going, no, we'll not be playing that one then.
Skip a bit.
Yeah. And then In the Lab introduces an additional mechanic that changes the way you cure the viruses. And
you also get nice little component upgrades as well, don't you?
Yes.
Little Petri dishes. And...
Yeah, you get Petri dishes in On the Brink, and you get little sort of virus sample bottles and things in the lab. And one of them is yellow, and it really does look like just a sample bottle. It really does look like someone's peed in a jar. It's quite disconcerting.
Andy, you haven't...
No. Thankfully, it's solid plastic. You can't just sort of take the lid off and go, pour it out. But that's actually quite a nice mechanic, the little sort of lab board, you get an extra board, and the way so you move things around. It's quite groovy.
Right. Have you heard about the new one that's come out this year?
No.
Do tell.
Pandemic Cthulhu.
Whoa.
Now, I'm not quite sure if this is amazing or really stupid.
So, how does that... So, Cthulhu's dropping virus bombs? What?
Well, once they're viruses, they're like cultists cropping up. Okay. And if there's enough of them, then they summon one of the great old gods.
Oh, good lord.
Now,
so, that sounds like...
Arkham Horror, an Eldritch Horror, which is why I can't work out if it's an amazing idea or a really stupid idea, because all it's doing is, it's replicating Eldritch Horror, because Eldritch Horror, when somebody said Eldritch Horror, I thought, well, that's a mixture between Arkham Horror and Pandemic. Map of the world, moving around, trying to stop the great old ones from rising.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at it, and the thing is, it looks really nice.
Is this not a leak on it?
I think what they've done is they've taken the Pandemic game, and I think someone else has developed the Cthulhu I think. Don't hold me to that. I've probably got that wrong, and somebody's screaming at their iPod at the moment.
They're typing furiously on their keyboards now, to the point where the spacebar's just pinged off. Judah, how dare you?
Something's wrong on the internet.
My frustration.
Action stations.
The alarm, the sirens going off, there's a red light flashing around, they've changed the bulb and everything. Oh, good lord. So is it, do you know who's making it at all? No.
It's
the same people who
same
do
people it. Same people.
Zedman games.
Zedman. We're going to say Zedman because we're British, goddammit.
Yes, we are.
We're drinking tea and eating scones. Yeah. It's Zedman games.
Tally ho.
Yes, put these bloody colonists in their place.
Yes. Queen's English.
So, okay, so it's odd then. So
yeah, I can't work out. As I said, I've seen it, and I've seen some pictures of it, and it looks really, really nice.
Okay.
But it's whether it does anything. If it's just Pandemic with a skin. Mm. Then there's not much point. It would have to do something different to Pandemic, really.
Sure.
But then again, if it's going to do something different to Pandemic, how close is it going to be to Eldritch Horror then?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know where it's going
to go. Have to wait and see, I guess.
Yeah.
So who makes the Eldritch and Arkham games?
That's Fantasy Flight.
It is Fantasy Flight, yeah, okay.
Speaking of kind of cooperative games.
Semi-co-op. Yeah.
Semi-cooperative. We both played The Curse of the Black Dice.
Arr.
Okay. The Curse of the Black Dice.
Shiver me timbers and try and be semi-cooperative.
Yes. So the reason why we say semi-cooperative is this game is a game where you're on a pirate ship and the aim is to collect gold, mm-hmm. but you have to be the player who gains the most gold.
Right, makes sense.
But if you screw up, the pirate ship sinks and you all die, it's game over and no one gets anything.
Okay.
So you want to try and collect as much gold as you can without basically scuttling the ship in the process.
Yeah.
But beating your opponents as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
Obviously not physically, well, maybe physically. That's how competitive you are, I suppose.
The way it's done is you get this little board which represents the deck of the ship. Mm-hmm. And then you get a whole bunch of black dice.
Right. It's roll them. Title game, but...
Yeah. Yeah. Roll them up and you put them against whichever... There's six rows on the deck.
Right.
You put them against there. And turn by turn, you'll roll your colour of dice, which we've got exactly the same face as the black dice.
Okay.
And you have to try and match what's on the ship board already.
Right.
So if there's five pirate flags, you need to get five or more pirate flags in that column amongst you as a team.
Otherwise, five black dice with a one particular symbol on, you've got to then roll with your own dice.
Yeah. Amongst the
collectively.
Team. Yeah.
So say, for example, if I rolled two in my turn, you'd roll two in your turn, and John rolled one. You could line them all up, and then you would get the benefit of that row.
Yes.
That's it.
Right, okay.
But what happens is you pick one of the symbols you rolled and all the dice of that symbol have to get placed down.
So you have to put them down?
So you have to put you have to put something down every turn.
Okay.
And it's up to you what you put down.
Yeah.
Right.
So you've got six different columns you can put them in. So some of them will be, right, we need to put them there so we don't get more black dice. So that's one of the possible effects. And you have to put things there to stop taking ship damage to the ship.
Okay. Yeah, so for each one of these, if you succeed, you get the bonus.
Yeah.
And if you fail, if you don't have as many as there are black dice, then you get the bad stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, some of them don't really have rewards, and some of them don't really have punishments. But generally speaking...
it all evens out.
Yeah. Okay. Interesting.
Where it comes a bit sneaky, and I think we're playing two players, like, again, it didn't really work with two players. I think you need four players for this.
Right.
Because then one person could be an arsehole.
Why are you looking at me?
Because he spent the whole game staring at me with that same look.
I was going to say, it's usually Cage that's the wanker, not me.
So that one of the slots will be collect gold coins, and there might be like collect one gold coin or collect two gold coins. And with more people, it's very easy to go, oh, look, I've rolled three treasure maps. I need to put three treasure maps on, but we only need two, Steve. Yeah, but three, I've got three now. Better go have it now.
What are you up to?
Yeah.
So does everyone have... Well, you're insinuating there that there's motive.
Yes.
So explain.
Because there was a one winner, so it's the one winner with the most gold at the end of the game wins. So... you're limited by where you can place it based on what you rolled.
Yeah. Mm.
But there's nothing saying you have to beat the black dice first. Or you might say, oh, we don't care if we get an extra black dice. It doesn't matter. We'll all go grab the gold.
So I'll just get some treasure maps. And coincidentally, I get two gold for that.
Yeah.
What are the odds? So do you have individual targets? Or does everyone has the same target?
Everyone's
you've just
got
to try and beat a really good con man.
And
yeah.
some of them, only the first person to get something on that particular reward gets the reward. So you might have one which needs like three black dice to succeed, and the failure is something bad like taking a hole in the ship. But only the first person gets a gold as a reward, and everyone after that, well, they're just, you know, being chivalrous and helping the cause.
Yeah.
So it sounds like that it makes sense for you as a player to stick your dice on something that otherwise would cause damage to the ship, for example, and make everybody else lose the game. So if you get in there first, everyone else is motivated to help you out because otherwise everyone would sink the ship, for example.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
If the ship sinks, then that's it. Yeah. Everyone loses. Yeah. So you kind of need to do enough that you make it through while simultaneously making sure that you're the one that gets the most gold.
Hmm. That sounds interesting.
In a way, it's really thematic because it's a bit like, you know, being on a bunch of cutthroat pirates, really, and backstabbing you.
I like the sound of this.
It works really well. And because it's... because obviously the dice rolls have a little bit of randomness as well. You can't just be conniving, and sometimes you'll get a bit stuffed up by them. Like towards the end, if you're still rolling a couple of dice, you might end up with just nothing that gives you any benefit. Mm. It might be ones that have already. You get rum tokens as well, so you can spend rum tokens.
Is it always gone?
My rum, especially.
You could spend the rum tokens to re-roll.
Yeah.
But you could also spend the rum tokens to activate special powers.
So there's some extra pirates on the side, and they each had things that they could do. Like they could turn one dice to the opposite face.
Oh.
Allow you to re-roll a dice or pick the number on it.
Yeah.
The clever thing about them is they all had a rum limit. So if they exceeded their rum limit, they got drunk and fell overboard.
And that's outstanding.
That was also a lose condition. If the entire crew had fallen overboard, there was no one to crew the ship, so you were just left adrift in the sea.
Oh, that's brilliant.
So you lost the game as well.
Oh, wow, that's amazing.
It's a really clever little game, actually.
Yeah, good fun.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So is it another cheap game? So you sort of 15 quid or something like that?
I bought it at Essen, so I can't remember how much I spent, but it wasn't much. That might be about 20 euros or something.
Oh, that's pretty good. Okay, so it is just literally a cardboard board and a shitload of dice.
Yeah.
All right, okay.
Yeah, a couple of rum tokens, a couple of gold tokens. Mm. Yeah.
No actual rum, though. No. That's disappointing. Someone needs to make a limited edition version. Right, I'll get to Kickstarter.
I'm sure we can get a bottle of rum if we want to play.
Bottle of Kraken rum.
I've got some just next door.
Mm.
Why didn't that occur to us?
Release the Kraken.
To be honest, we said we'd have a glass of whiskey when we're playing, and we didn't forget as well that you've got the rum conditioned.
That's true.
Rum cask finished whiskey. So
we're doing
have
it
that.
Very
oh,
wrong.
Excellent.
We're going completely wrong. So we didn't drink rum. We didn't drink the rum finished whiskey.
Amateurs.
Rum finished whiskey.
We'd better have another game.
Yes.
But at the rum finished whiskey. That's, I like the sound of that.
Yeah.
Speaking of cards and cheap games.
Yeah.
Battle for Solariac.
Yes. The argument of a bunch too.
Yes.
So Battle for Solaria. So yeah, Battle for Solaria. Now, when we originally recorded this episode, it was about half of its Kickstarter. I wonder whether this will be out in time. It's on Kickstarter now. That might be too late for you listeners at home.
Depends how quick you are editing.
Yes. That'll be a no then.
Mm. Well, this is sober now, so we'll be all right. It should require less editing.
You can but hope.
Yeah, let's hope. It's two-player... Oh, I don't want to use the word collectible card game because... It's not really collectible. I don't know what term to use. I tend to use expandable card game.
Netrunner clone.
Yeah, magic clone. Magic clone, but it's a sci-fi game, and it's very much based on resources. Mm. The best way to think of it is a RTS game in card game form. So you have to mine. You have to mine resources. Which
actually, that's a really good point. Put my teeth in. That's a really good way of putting it, actually.
Yeah, you build up some resources, use that to make buildings. The resource from the buildings allows you to bring out units.
Mm.
Units have to attack the buildings first. So it's a bit like your base in like Command and Conquer.
Yeah.
Where you have your outer buildings, you start destroying them so they can't build more units, and then last of all, go to the base, end the game.
And it makes a lot of sense when you explain it like that, which isn't the way Steve explained it when we played it last time. It took me a little bit longer to get my head around it as a result, but...
Yeah, I didn't twig on that concept until about a week after we played.
Mm. But that said, it was a really good game. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, it was... I've got to say, unfortunately, the rule book that comes with it, I got a little starter set, which was two decks, with some extra cards, and some instructions. The instructions that came with it were bloody awful.
Lacking.
Lacking.
It doesn't really cover it, does it?
Lacking is a more accurate term, because... they were lacking in descriptions of some very important concepts.
Most of the rules.
Yeah, so I had this little rulebook open. I also had an iPad on me, which had the rules that I downloaded, which was in proper like tournament format, so it sounded like an instruction manual translated from Japanese.
Into English, back to Japanese, and then back to English again.
Yeah. So, it was a bit of a learning process.
Yeah, because we played it first, didn't we, Steve? And then you two played it the following night.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And because you've played as both sides now, Steve, because I handed your arse to you twice on the first night.
Yep.
And you were playing as the ground-based troops.
Yeah.
So the following night, you swapped sides thinking, right, I'm going to play as the side that won last night. Come on then, John. And he promptly then handed your arse to you as well.
Yeah.
I think it was very much luck of the draw.
Well, so as a bit of a background, there's two factions in this starter set, which can best be described as Hawkmen and Skynet and Terminators.
Mm.
So the Hawkmen were the air-based unit. The Skynet was basically the ground force, because they had loads of buildings which generated resources. They had lots of resources. Whereas the flying guys had, was it just a flight special ability? So they could attack anyone.
Most, if not
to.
All of them, they did, yeah. But no point did Brian Blessed turn up. I was very disappointed.
No. Dive!
It's amazing.
So, I kind of thought the same as you, that it was so dependent on the look of my deck. Now, I think the decks could have been tweaked slightly to give you a bit more spread. But the basic gist of how we played the first game, which I think is more of how the game was supposed to be played with those decks, is that Andy brought out loads of Hawkmen, kept destroying all my bases, and I was slowly building up more and more energy resources, which I could then use to launch a nuke.
Which then just battered me completely.
Yeah.
I think it was actually more like an ion cannon, but same difference.
Yeah.
It was, and certainly playing as the Hawkman twigged for me, as you say, the RTS sort of style. So I kind of got the idea pretty quickly, but then I play a lot of RTS games, which I have done in the past.
So did I. It just
twigged. I thought, right, okay, I'll support him, and I've got all of this resource, I can deploy this monster, who then sort of goes into your base and beats the crap out of you. But the one mechanic that I don't really understand right now, and I think it's kind of broken, is that when you do damage to somebody's structure, if you really pile on the damage, any excess hit points that you can cause don't sort of go to the structure behind or anything to the side. They go directly to the player.
Oh, no, they went to the structure behind. If you're doing a ground-based assault, the damage went to the structure behind.
Right.
But because you were the Hawkmen, you were attacking the back rank.
Right.
So the damage went straight onto me.
Which maybe makes you think that if you're attacking the back rank, whether it should still somehow go, whether you can't then lay on the damage beyond that.
Yeah.
Because it just goes to the back rank, or
it just seemed a bit silly, because I could just bypass anything that Steve had built or the ground people had built and just throw every unit I had at one simple structure. And then anything beyond that, all the hit points would go to his actual, you know, hit points thing. And not only that, you lose the equivalent number of hit points that the building's influence is worth as well. Just like kind of a double whammy.
Yeah. So from your perspective, you hit his weakest structure with everything, the entire army, cyclone missile launcher, the lot.
Exactly. Yeah. And it batters him in like a turn. And it just, to me, that seems like a really bad broken mechanic.
Yeah.
Or we misunderstand the rules.
Which is entirely possible based on what we said about our thoughts on the rulebook. Yeah, it was just bizarre as well. I found that a bit counterintuitive as well, because I don't think either of you have played Magic the Gathering, have you?
No,
but I'm aware of its work.
That concept is in Magic, but only on particular creatures. Mm. I can't remember the name of the keyword now. It's either overflow or stampede or something like that.
Mm.
Which only creatures that have that ability can pass on that overflow of damage.
Right, okay.
Normally, if you attack a creature, it doesn't matter if you've got 10 attack and that creature's got 1 defense.
Mm.
You just do all 10 damage to that one creature and it dies.
Okay. Which sort of makes sense.
Exactly,
yeah.
But if you've got a creature that's got this, and I'm damned if I can remember the bloody keyword now, but if you've got a creature that's got this ability, then you want to try and block it with something hard, because you're going to be taking that extra damage. So I was quite surprised this was standard in the rules and not a keyword.
Seems a bit weird, but no, I don't play Magic. No. It's like football cards for neckbeards, it really is.
shiny, got.
Oh, it's very much that, yeah.
So presumably then there are other decks available and extras that you can add to it?
At the moment, there's the box set I've got, and that comes with more cards than you need, so you can tweak the deck. The Kickstarter they've got out at the moment is actually for the first expansion, which will give you another 120 or so cards, I think it is, to tweak the decks even further.
Right.
What they've done is they've gone for this Kickstarter standard approach. So rather than going, right, here's everything, they're kind of saying, right, here's a starter set, we're going to go forth, and I think they said they're going to do 3 or 4 Kickstarters slowly trickling in.
Okay, yeah.
Right.
The extra cards, extra factions. Because there's only essentially 2.5 factions at the moment. So 2.5, because there was the 2 factions we played with, and there was mercenary cards which could play for either side.
Right.
And I think you can make a deck out of the mercenaries if you want.
Right, so just freelancers just having a pot because they've got bored and nothing else to do.
Yeah.
Interesting. So does that mean potentially you could play as a 3-player game?
No, that's a 2-player game only.
Right, okay.
They tend to find these games, you can play them multiplayer, but they never really work very well.
Yeah, I can't imagine how the mechanics would...
Yeah, well, there's like 4-player rules for Magic, which I've tried online but not in real life. And another one of my favourites in this genre is Doomtown. Doomtown, you can play 4-player. We tried it once and said, we're never doing this again. Because it took far too long. And because somebody wasn't paying attention, somebody won without actually doing anything, which was really annoying.
It wasn't a bad game, though. I say once we got the hang of it, it was... Our second game was definitely a lot closer than the first. I know how it worked for you two.
No, I couldn't get any buildings out, which means I couldn't get any troops out. And then when I did start getting buildings out, since John had troops out, you were just hitting them, weren't you?
Yeah, and better than that, I had most of my troops in hiding as well. So I had one guy who could buff the rest of my army, and he spent one turn out in the field and then just hid, buffing everyone from a distance.
Yeah. So I couldn't even nuke him.
No.
I couldn't even use the nuke card on him.
Oh, no way.
There was nothing to nuke.
No.
Well, not that you could see, anyway.
Nothing to see here. Take your nukes home.
Yeah, I don't think we really scratched the surface of the game, really.
I think it's definitely worth a few more playthroughs.
Yeah, I'd like to play a few more before writing it off entirely.
Yeah.
There were definitely sort of a lot of things I did like about it and how it worked well. And so you build up your deck at the back to build influence, which is obviously, you know, you're building up your resources and also. So that element of it I quite liked. It seemed to work quite well. And obviously you can choose what you put in there.
Yeah.
And if you wanted to reveal it, you could do. And I thought that was quite a nice touch.
Yeah.
That worked quite well.
And the fact that you get these sort of one-off tactics that allow you to, like, maybe deal some... That was the other thing. I managed to deal probably about 9 damage to you just from revealing some of these tactic cards as they went on. So before any of us had even attacked with a troop, you were down to sort of half points or something.
Yeah.
That's pretty much what happened in our second game. Steve launched a nuke at me and he had ridiculous amounts of Solarium being generated, so I went from 25 pit points to 9 in a single turn.
I was just waiting for another nuke to come up. Yeah. I didn't really know the deck, so I didn't know whether it was just one nuke in there or two. I ended up with 4. But they're at the bottom of the deck, so I'm like, come on.
So, thankfully, I managed to throw out a load of Hawkmen and just battered one of his structures. So, but yes, it was... I think you're right, it would definitely require a little bit of deck tweaking and a few more playthroughs. But I think it's got promise, but I'm still not convinced about this weird base-destroying mechanic.
I don't think we've scratched the surface of it, really. I think we've just had a couple of learning games, which is a bit of a shame because... It's a busy market. It's up against a lot of games of a similar genre. Mm. And as we found, we had games that were completely lost based on what cards we drew.
Yeah.
And
there's always going to be some element. I mean, maybe it's just that, you know, when you get more used to the game, you would play it quicker.
Yeah.
And you'd have the opportunity to build your own... Maybe those decks are a little bit skewed.
Yeah.
And you wouldn't necessarily build them the way those ones were built.
It wasn't a bad game. But yeah. I'm not hugely used to playing card games. I played Netrunner with you, Steve. And I quite enjoyed that, actually, once I got the hang of it.
That takes a bit of getting your head around that game.
Yeah.
I like that game.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I quite enjoyed it. It's a nice game, it's Netrunner. Mm-hmm. So I can see...
But my problem with Netrunner is it suffers from the same thing all those games does that Magic does as well, is ideally you need someone else to play against.
Mm. That's no fun on your own, is it?
And then you get the kind of... Well, what I mean is you need someone to come up with their own deck.
Yeah.
So I mean, I've got, I could make Netrunner, I could make two decks and just kind of go, right, do you want to be the hacker or the corporation, and off you go. But ideally you want that other person to have gone, right, I've made this new corporation deck, let's try it out.
Bring it on.
But also that leads to this kind of escalation where somebody goes, ooh, that set's got this card in, I'm going to go buy some extra cards. And you end up only buying like the base set and just getting your ass handed to you every time you play because that other person's got more cards. I mean, Magic's terrible for that.
Yeah.
You know, Magic, you can go out and buy, you know, the best card in the world, spend like 20 quid a card. Lots of cheap ones.
I'm sure I saw something online about someone spending, I don't know, $20,000 or something on a particular card, some Black Orchid, something
Black
other.
Black Lotus?
That could be it, yeah.
Oh my Black God. Lotus is renowned for being the rarest Magic card there is.
Okay.
And it's also a really powerful card in the game. So players want it for their deck for competitions, yet it's extremely rare. So I can't remember, it's thousands and tens of thousands, I think that goes for the last time that's sold. I mean, I've got one card which I priced up and it was like 65 or 75 quid it was selling for.
Bloody hell.
Technically, it's Amanda, so I can't really sell it either.
Would she know?
No, she wouldn't now. A couple of years ago, she might have spotted it. She wouldn't have a clue. Yeah.
Besides, it's been on eBay for...
And provided she doesn't listen to this podcast, she'll never know.
No, she'll never know.
Secret is safe.
Awesome. I'd say, no, I think... I scoff at this, but having just spent, you know, £75 on the game...
Yeah, it's... different
horses for courses, isn't it?
It's a
really
different part of the genre, isn't it? So
But yeah, we played another one that you wanted to play, you were desperate to play.
Did I have to get a review out? But was it a Kickstarter?
I think it was, actually. Because I remember you approached John and I a couple of weeks ago saying, right, guys, I've got like 2 pages worth of these bloody things. Help. I've got review fodder. Who's in awesome time?
I've had 3 more games turn up since we last discussed.
You know, some
2
people,
more coming in the post.
Some people, Steve, would be delighted to have that.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, well, I'm more than willing to share the love, but you've got to write some reviews for the website if you do.
That's fair. I could do that. There might be slightly sweary reviews. But...
So I'll take it you're talking about Expeditions then.
Yes. Because that was the weirdest board game I've ever played, I think. Well, I'll say it's not even a board game, it's kind of a card-ish game.
It's kind of an RPG as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So, Expeditions is an app-based RPG/cooperative game. So, we played with the iPad. I think you can play it with any kind of tablet or phone. I don't think you can play it on a laptop. It is... I say app-based, it's not an app you download, you just go onto a website and it runs all off the website.
Should be any tablet, anything.
But it doesn't work on a PC for some reason.
That's weird.
Now, one of the reasons for that is you need to be able to touch the screen.
That is probably the big reason, then.
Yeah.
Well, maybe with like a Microsoft Surface or something. Anyway.
Yeah.
Spot who's the computer software guy in the room.
We played the cooperative game,
yes.
Which is like a choose-your-own-adventure.
It really is.
Yeah. So the game will present you with a story, which was very cheesy. And it quite literally...
town of Gruyere.
In the town of Gruyere. And we had to rescue the stolen cheese.
Oh, man. That was brilliant. Lots of jokes about cheese.
Well, there wasn't. That was what disappointed me. Apart from Gruyere and they were stolen some cheese. That was it. I was expecting loads more.
So there's nothing about masking ponies or...
No, or approaching angry Welsh cheeses.
Carefully.
None of that in there.
Oh, they missed a trick. You never know, though. It was only a beater. True. They might hear this podcast and go, these boys are onto something.
Or Yogi and his cheese. Anyway, moving swiftly on.
So, you had the choices. So, like, choose your adventure. It would say, do you want to follow the thief into the sewer? Yes or no? Do you want to... take left or right turns in the sewers, that kind of thing. But when it got to combat, it got really interesting. Because everyone had a separate character which had separate skills. And these skills were taken from the names of decks, basically. So I think you played a wizard character, didn't you? So you...
I was the boisterous mage or the drunken mage or something like that. Because every character isn't just you're a mage or a rogue or something. Yeah, everyone had a little, almost like a foible.
Yeah.
Like, you were the drunken... mayor or the
I was the hungry halfling in the first game.
That's it, yes. Yeah.
Okay, so it's not like just, you know, the mighty warrior or...
No, they were
silly things. Yeah, they were almost like negative things. There was definitely a drunkard.
The bumbling mage or...
Yeah, pretty much.
It was stuff like that. So, obvious character flaws that we pretty much all suffer from.
Yeah. Each character had skill decks they could choose from. So I think that the halfling was a bard, so he had music and attack.
Deluded mage, there we go.
Deluded mage, that was it. So you picked up a deck of these cards, and every time it came to combat, you had to shuffle a card, draw three, right, and it would go on the iPad, and then you had to pick which of those skills you were going to do this round. Okay. And once you picked it, you had to touch the screen on the iPad, and the round wouldn't end until every single player had touched the iPad.
Yeah.
While this is happening, it's the screen's updating, showing you how much damage you're being hit by.
Hit one, hit two.
What was the other one? Surge. Incoming surge. So, of course, then there's this stress then that you've got to choose quickly. And everyone, you know, it says, so for four players, it knows to expect four fingers on the touchpad.
Right.
I suppose you could cheat, just put three fingers down in one go. No, we're all honest.
Which meant it was really quite stressful, especially if it drew a load of crap skills. I mean, the first character I had, the halfling, it was a bard. It was mostly buffs, which I think would have been great if you were playing with like four or five players. But just the two of us, it was like, no, we need to hit that giant rat. We had to hit it hard. So it
yes,
like,
we do.
Oh, this one, stuff it.
You have taken six damage. God damn it!
And it also,
it doesn't help when you're fumbling through your three cards and then drop them on the floor.
Yes.
So it's a little bit like the end of a round of Robo Rally, where you're all picking your cards, and then if you're the last person, you turn over an egg timer,
yes,
and you've got to pick your cards. So you're trying to do what you need to do, but at the same time, you don't want to completely stuff things up. So you just quickly, and then at the end, it's like, oh, fuck it, I'll just put these three down.
Yes, yeah, very much
exactly like that.
And
yes,
also, it's cooperative, so you could say, well, you're supposed to be communicating and saying, well, I'll heal, I'll attack, I'll hit it with a range.
You don't get time.
You don't say it like that. You go, I'm healing!
I'm healing as well!
Oh, my.
Why are you both healing?
Why not?
But, again, that's on Kickstarter at the moment, I hope. I hope it's still on Kickstarter by the time this goes out. It might be near its end. But it was a really interesting concept.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
It was, as you say, what we played was quite a short adventure. There only, what was it, two, maybe three encounters we had combat-wise?
Yeah.
And the second one we got thoroughly dicked.
Yes.
I mean, we had enough trouble with the rat, and then we encountered, what was it? We encountered these two you see somebody at the end of the tunnel. Do you sort of run away, or do you sort of take him on? I said, no, fuck it, we'll take him on. Bang. Well, that was a mistake. Because then we took on this ridiculously hard guy who had two backups. Steve got knocked out, so I had to take these guys on my own. And then somehow, because I got a surge or something, another dude turned up. So it's like me, this crappy little mage with no hit points, taking on three big armoured bastards.
I'm guessing it didn't go well.
No, that did not last long.
We reset the game, we picked a different character, and we did a bit better.
And the second time we ran through it, we said, nah, we'll run away. And then they chased us.
So the trick is just don't encounter them.
Yeah, pretty much. You can't. Yeah. That's the thing, because the game leads you through it. But I think it was an interesting concept. I really liked it because it had tension. It had hilarity because the descriptions you get as you go through the game, the commentary was actually quite lighthearted, and it was very self-aware.
Yeah.
That it was.
So is it always the same path then? If you did the same one twice.
It was for this one. I think.
Yes.
Because it was only very, very limited.
This was like a demo version.
Yeah, right. Yeah. So I'm sure once, hopefully, the full version comes out, I imagine it will be a lot more branching. Mm. Yes. I hope.
There's potential there, and I think it needs that to really fulfil its potential.
Would it be like a random kind of thing, or is it just that there are...
No,
here's one expedition.
I think it would be a set story. You know, we were talking about time stories a few weeks back.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
I think it would be like that. It's a set adventure, and this is the story you're going to play. Okay. So, like a choose your own adventure. But you could also play it as an RPG.
Mm. Okay.
So, where one person played like a DM, made the story up, and you didn't have to use the iPad then to choose what you were doing.
Right.
But they would just use the iPad for the combat.
You have to put your finger on them or something.
Get off!
Poke him in the eye.
That's it, you're dead.
Finger up your nose.
So you start to put your finger on the iPad for the combat, because combat was just, he would just pick a monster and say, right, you're fighting him, and then combat would be the same as if you were playing the cooperative. Yeah.
Okay.
But then all the decisions you'd make through the game would be based on the DM.
Yeah.
Because we didn't do that because there's only two of us, and there was quite a bit more prep as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
Players, so.
But I think it's got a lot of promise. It was actually a really good film. Yeah. We should give it a go.
We should, I agree.
It's, very entertaining.
Right, well, we're getting on well into time. So let's do some questions, shall we? First question is from Paul Grogan from Gaming Rules, which is at Gaming Rules Vids on Twitter, which is also the Gaming Rules YouTube channel and podcast. Yeah, both worth a listen and a look.
Look at the podcast and listen to the YouTube.
Yeah, look at the podcast, listen to YouTube, yeah.
You're doing it wrong.
What are you most looking forward to at the UK Games Expo? Now, he has suggested his own answer here.
Really?
Which was meeting Paul Grogan and playing Codenames Pictures.
Well, obviously.
And I must say, I'm really looking forward to playing Codenames Pictures.
Yeah?
Did you play Codenames, John? I can't remember if you did or not.
I was in the process of making cocktails on that particular New Year's Eve party.
Ah.
So,
I've
right.
seen the box.
So I did play it, but I missed the bit where you were explaining the rules, which consequently made it quite difficult.
You participated.
I did. I got a lot of things wrong. I learnt a lot. And the next time we play, I might stand a chance.
That sounds like your average board game experience, John.
Yeah, pretty much.
So very quickly, Codenames is you have a grid of words in front of you. And it's a word association game where one player is a spy master and knows which of those words are the code names of the spies, and has to convey to his team clues. So they'll say Japan 3, and then the team has to guess which of those words relate to Japan.
Right,
so
okay.
So it might be Tokyo, Kaiju, Katana, something like that.
Right, okay.
The fun comes where this game works best with six players, I found. Six or more. Anything less than that, it's not quite as much.
It's quite a few. It's just basically a party
game. It is a party game, yeah. Right, so okay. If you can get 6 to 8 people, it works brilliantly, because you were saying before about the cooperative thing where one person can always screw it up.
Yes.
Here we play go. Codenames, you'll have one person that completely screws it up, because they'll get a completely different... So you'll get the first person go, oh, it's obviously Tokyo, it's obviously Katana, it's obviously Kaiju. And then somebody goes, what about rice?
No.
Well, rice isn't as strong. Yeah, but rice, Japan, you know, sushi, you have rice.
Mm.
Oh, bugger. So which one is it? And then you're sitting there thinking, you've just given these clues, thinking that was bloody obvious. And they said the right answers to begin with. Biting your tongue. Going, what is that moron just said rice?
Never playing with John again.
So Codenames Pictures is the same game, but instead of it being words, it's going to be pictures.
Hence the title. I see what they've done there.
Yeah. So I'm really intrigued how that's going to work, because I think it's going to be the same games, the same rules, but it's going to mix things up a lot.
So almost a little bit more like Dixit or something along those lines.
Yes. And I've heard of people play Codenames using Dixit cards.
Oh, good lord.
Which to me sounds like a complete mindfuck.
Yeah. We got some pretty random answers out of the ones that we played with.
I've been led to believe the cards aren't quite as out there.
Right.
As Dixie.
You don't need quite as many drugs to play this game.
No, they're a bit more standardised.
Mm. You don't need to dupe down an entire bottle of cough medicine before you play.
You don't need to, it's still fun though, right?
Oh yeah,
so. Yeah. So we're actually trying to answer Paul's question, what we're looking forward to at the UK Game Expo. Right, I'm not going to try and look forward to too much in particular, because I do this at every convention. Mm. I say I'm going to see this, this, this and this, and I end up seeing the first one. Because
and just focusing on that.
You just never seem to have enough time. Yeah. Like, you never seem to have enough time to do absolutely everything you want. So I'm kind of going to go with the flow a little bit. I mean, I'm looking forward to the Games Expo as it is.
Mm.
I'm looking forward to what we see. And we've already got some slots booked in to play a couple of games, which should be interesting.
Yeah, dreadfully organised of you.
So expect a podcast afterwards where we do a bit of a debrief.
Mm. And even during.
If we're
feeling sassy.
Yes. But other than that, because you two have never been to the Expo before, have you?
No. Expo virgins.
We are indeed virgins of the Expo.
This is our cherry popper.
I'm looking forward to it. I don't really know what to expect, so I'm just going to take it as it comes and see.
No, I'm the same as John, because I'm not really sure what to expect other than a large space and a lot of sweaty beards.
It's not quite that bad.
Okay, that's good.
The magic tournament will be in a different building. One of the things they have done, actually, they've expanded so much over the last, I think, 6 years. They've gone from a tiny hotel in the middle of Birmingham to the Hilton, which is just outside the NEC. Mm. And this year's going to be the first year in the NEC.
That's massive.
But they've still got the hotel.
Oh, wow.
So the hotel...
isolated the magic.
So all the tournaments are going to be in the hotel. Oh, last year, they had to have like massive marquees outside to do the Netrunner.
Oh, wow.
The Netrunner and X-Wing tournaments. I mean, there are hundreds of people playing Netrunner and then hundreds of people playing X-Wing.
Good Lord.
And so that's all going to be in the hotel. So there's going to be... You tend to find, actually, you go there first thing in the morning, it's really busy because the tournaments start about an hour after it begins.
Okay.
So once the tournaments begin, like, half the people disappear and you go, oh, I can breathe now. It's still really busy, but it's you know,
you can move around. I'm quite looking forward to the merch stands.
Yes.
I'll be twitching with acquisition disorder.
Yes.
Good job we've been paid.
Yes.
God, it's right after payday, isn't it?
It is. It's a dangerous time.
Ever so.
And the beauties as well would be driving, so we've got a car boot.
I've now got a big car. The Igo's been upgraded.
The Igo's Igon.
Yes, substantially larger boot that can fit something like four sets of golf clubs in, which is a lot of board games. But, I mean, not just the shops, but also just to see, you know, how all of these games play. Lots and lots of games I've never seen before, games I have seen before and not seen being played. You know, maybe, oh, look, I am actually doing it wrong. And just go, oh, actually, you're shit at this, aren't you? you should do that. I'm going to be that guy.
Just stand over people's shoulders.
Yeah, you don't want to do that.
Really? With those cards? Sure.
That'd be brilliant just to fuck with people. I'm just going to sit there with my cat ears on, you know. Be that guy.
It's like that classic thing. If you're ever lost in the wilderness, how do you get rescued? And the simple answer is to just start playing solitaire. And when someone rocks up to tell you that you should have just put that card over there on that one, you can ask them how to get out.
Or that one before.
Stab him and eat him. That's outstanding.
Saved either way.
Mm.
Okay, so second question from Heavy Cardboard Podcast. That's at Heavy Cardboard on Twitter. Any designers you're keen on meeting?
Yes, actually. I can't pronounce his name because he's Finnish. But the dude who designed Eclipse, because I love Eclipse. I mean, I'll talk about it in a future podcast because I could ramble on for hours about that.
And anything else for that matter.
Cheeky! But fair.
That's what this entire podcast is based on. Poking Andy and letting him go and we'll just go make a cup of tea in the other room.
And then rein him back in.
And the choke chain's been removed. But because I really love Eclipse and it's such a tight game and there's so many elements to it, it's kind of understanding just how on earth you make a game like that and put it under so much control. Now, I have recently bought Twilight Imperium, which I haven't played yet at all.
That's definitely on my to-play list.
Yes, we'll have to have a game of that at some point.
We're going
to
put a day aside for that. And we've got to do homework before we play that. Yeah. That's not a game we're going to learn to play when the board's out there.
Apparently it takes at least an hour to even start to learn. So,
yes.
We'll set aside a weekend for that game.
Yes.
But that style of game, I love 4X games. So I'd like to meet him or another 4X games designer.
I've been quite lucky because doing stuff for the website and doing stuff for the UK Game Media Network, I've managed to meet quite a few designers. So, I mean, I've met people that I really wanted to meet anyway. I mean, I met Eric Lang last year at the UK Games.
Oh, amazing.
So he's the designer of Chaos in the Old World, Arcadia Quest, Blood Rage. You know, he's pretty much one of the top tier designers at the moment. The guy is bonkers in a nut, though. I mean, really, he's like a mad professor. You can see why he can design so many
games. He's got the hair to go with it.
Oh, yes.
Awesome. Great Scott.
He's got this great big huge vertical bushy hair. It's
amazing.
He looks a bit crazy and he's a bit crazy, but he's a really nice chap. And that's one thing I would say about this industry, is it's still not a huge industry. So you go to these gaming conventions, you bump into these people, and everyone's like really, really nice and really friendly.
Oh, that's cool. That's good to know.
I haven't met anyone as a knob end.
Well, that's good. Until I've been.
What about you, John?
To be perfectly honest, I've got a really shit memory. So I can never remember who makes things. So maybe my aim for this one will just be to try and actually put some names and faces to board games and then start to make some associations. But
one of the people I would like to meet, actually, thinking about it, is Steve Jackson and Ian Livingstone.
Oh, yeah.
So the guys who basically set up Games Workshop. They created Games Workshop from a little tiny corner shop in the middle of London. They imported Dungeons and Dragons into the UK and actually made their own version of it. I think they licensed
Dungeoneer.
They printed Dungeons and Dragons.
Oh, really? England.
Yeah.
Oh, right. I thought it was TSR.
That was eventually when TSR started, and they got in touch and said, oh, can we print a copy in the UK, and bought the rights.
Oh, okay. So they almost franchised it.
Yeah.
Right.
And then eventually I think TSR took over, but at that point Games Workshop, they'd moved on to the Fighting Fantasy books.
Yes.
Yeah, well, after they brought Games Workshop up to a point. And then after that, I don't know what happened to Steve Jackson, but bear in mind, it's not the Munchkin Steve Jackson, which a lot of people get confused with, because there's two Steve Jacksons.
Are you
in the
saying
board game industry.
Steve Jackson is a Munchkin? Are you? The Munchkin is Steve Jackson.
Yeah, the Munchkin Steve Jackson. Yeah. But then Ian Livingstone went on to work, I think even formed Eidos. So he went into the video game market.
Yes.
So he's involved with Tomb Raider and Lara Croft and bringing those games out.
Possibly, yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. I think they were a publisher. I don't know if they went the program.
Eidos are a publisher, yeah. Because Core Design wrote the original Tomb Raiders.
Yeah.
Until they got taken over by Shift over to America.
Yeah, this
to Crystal Dynamics. Hmm. Yes, but I believe it still is produced by Eidos, although recently Eidos have been bought out by Square Enix, which is why it's shit.
The irony is, Ian Livingstone now does a lot about introducing software and programming skills to schools.
Oh, okay.
He's a champion of that course, which means my wife, as a computing teacher, is more likely to meet him than I am.
Ooh, that must burn.
She will not know who he is either.
That's probably why Amanda and I are going to go around together.
Yes.
Oh, amazing. Yeah, I'll wait for that day when you come home and Amanda's like, guess who I met today? Some dude called Ian Livingstone. He's a really nice guy. You just sat there seething with rage.
Apparently he had something to do with Tomb Raider and Games Workshop. Okay, last question then from Andrew Mason. So it's at MasonApp77 on Twitter. If you attend any Games Day events, do you prefer to try new games or play games from your own collection?
Well, that's an easy one. Always try the new stuff.
Yes.
It's like that Untapped app. If you go into a pub and there's new beers you've never tried, of course you're going to try the new stuff. What if it's amazing?
Exactly.
What if it's the best beer in the world ever?
That's it.
That applies to board games, yeah. What if that board game you haven't played is better than everything else in your collection?
What if it's even better than Talisman? I mean, it's unlikely, but...
Let the audience make their own mind up on that.
Yes.
Why are my ears burning?
I'm about 50-50 on this because I'm a lot like that, and I get this on our regular gaming night because I take games in and I look across the tables and see another game I want to play. But at the same time, it's the opportunity for me to play the games I've got.
Yeah.
It's like the other week, I think we played Eldritch Horror, and I love Eldritch Horror, and I looked over and somebody was playing Nothing Personal. I kept thinking, I've not played Nothing Personal. I've heard really good things about Nothing Personal. Everyone says it's a game Steve's going to like.
And I'm sat here playing
Eldritch Horror.
Yeah,
but I like Eldritch
Horror.
And so the cycle continues.
Yes. That's the dilemma, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've rather shamefully, I haven't actually had a gaming day, or a sort of public one, like on the Tuesdays that you go to, for years. And I mean, like, sort of 25 to 30 years, because I think the last one I was at was actually at primary school. We had like a sort of games day, people bringing, you know, like Game of Life, and this was back when board games were shit. And I had like Yahtzee, and people had Mousetrap and all that sort of shit. It was great, but I was always just running around the room going, oh, look at all the game. I mean, my game's wank, but you know, let's have a look at everybody else's cool stuff. Although these days,
and you were playing that with the other kids.
Oh yeah, totally.
See, I think that's one of the catalysts of me getting into board games. Because I remember Hero. Oh my god! Oh, And this is us without booze. Did you put whiskey in your tea?
No, John might have done, but I didn't.
It's just in the air.
I was going to say, on one of those school days when you brought board games in, I remember bringing Hero Quest in. So I'd had it for Christmas.
You were that guy.
And I hadn't really played Hero Quest because I couldn't get any of my family to play it.
Mm.
And we basically played this for all day.
Yes.
We played for half the campaign in a day in school.
Awesome. I think a little bit like you, Steve, though. I am a bit 50-50 because I would like to play more of my own games.
Mm.
But at the same time, I do see John's point of view that shinies.
Mm.
Lots of shinies and pretties and how does that work? Let me play this. Oh, you beat me. Oh, this game's shit, isn't it?
I think it's partly as well because the games that I've got, I've played them like hundreds and hundreds of times.
Yeah.
I don't have as many sort of new games that I think, oh, I haven't really played that very much. Maybe I should, follow Andy's footsteps and
catch some acquisition disorder.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes. Amazon is a wonderful place.
I think I tend to play other people's games and then go, oh, that was a really good game, I'll buy that one. Mm, but then I'll play it on holiday for like a whole week in a cottage in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
So by the end of it, I'll be like, right, I've definitely got that one now.
Mm, yes. Because I still want to play buy Robo Rally.
Yeah.
Having played it once, I loved it.
There's a new version of that coming out soon.
Is it?
Yeah.
So is that like a reprint or a...
Yeah, well, it's a complete new version. So yeah, it's a reprint, so it's restyled.
Oh.
Don't know whether the map tiles are the same or whether they're new map tiles.
I think I saw some screenshots.
Photographs, John.
Some pictures of the thing. And I seem to remember being a little bit worried about what I saw.
Well, which version have you got? Have you got the Wizards of the Coast version? There's two versions been made of that game previously, and a lot of people complain that the second version of that game was nowhere near as good of quality as the first.
Okay. Right.
And I think you actually have the second one.
Maybe.
So.
The one that's currently available, maybe, at the moment.
Well, it hasn't been really available for a while. That's one of the reasons why we're printing it. Yeah. Is it?
Yeah. It's about £27. It's on my wish list, and I really need to get around to buying it, because it's dropped by about 2% since I added it, and that was about 6 months ago. So I think, do you know what? It's probably not going to get cheaper. I might as well buy it.
Yeah, okay.
And it's less than £30 now for it, so which I think is probably quite a good value.
Right, it's really good value.
Yeah.
Mm. We played that game a lot.
Yes.
Probably it has something to do with the fact that I'm a software engineer and therefore I quite enjoy programming things.
Yes. Do your programs end up the same way as the robots? What? Fucked up and sort of, you know,
disappearing into a pit.
Yeah.
Getting shot down by lasers.
So I think that's done for today. I think
we've
outstayed our welcome yet again.
Oh, we always do.
Thank you very much for listening, everyone. You've been listening to the Polyhedron Collidercast. I've been Steve Tudor. I've also got...
I've been Andy Lewis.
And John Cage.
If you'd like to see any more news, reviews or interviews, go check out polyhedroncollider.com. We're on Twitter at polyhedronc, Facebook.com/polyhedroncollider, and all kinds of other nice places on the internet like Flipboard and Pinterest and G+. But I'm not going to remember the links to them, so just go to polyhedroncollider.com and see the links at the top of the page.
And clicky, clicky, yes. Clicky.
Thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
All right, mate.